Welcome. Welcome to all who have come to worship with us at Trinity Presbyterian Church today on this first Sunday of Lent. We're glad that you're here. If you're a visitor or if you're a longtime member of the church, we hope you'll sign our friendship register. You'll find the link in your bulletin today. The flowers in the sanctuary for this Sunday are given by the Love family. The flowers are given to the glory of God, and in loving memory of Erskine and Gay Love, and Bill, Beth, and Sarah Love. In the month of February and in the month of March, I'm going to be hosting, along with some other church members, a series of conversations in person. We're going to be talking in February about the mission statements, the three mission statements Trinity has had in its history. If you're not in a small group and so you haven't had an opportunity to take a look at those mission statements and have a discussion about them, or even if you are in a small group, but you'd enjoy talking to other people beyond the usual folks that you are in conversation with, we hope you'll join us. We're going to be meeting outside in the Williams Hall courtyard. And you do need to register because we're limited to 20 persons per gathering, but there will be several times. And so we hope you'll go to the e-newsletter or to our website and find ways that you can sign up and be part of these conversations. The first one is actually today, Sunday at 3 p.m. We hope to see some of you there. Also, there are new adult education offerings that have started this morning, but it's not too late to join a class that's in progress or to catch up by watching the recorded class online. This Thursday, we're going to be kicking off a new offering entitled Reading James Baldwin in a Community of Faith. Now, for more information about the James Baldwin class or our Sunday morning offerings, one of which is called What About the Children, and the other, Paul for Today, please visit the church website or the February edition of the Trinity Times or any of our e-newsletters and emails. Also, the Mission Council is offering us our chance to participate in a mission endeavor in the season of Lent. 40 things in 40 days will be going on from now through April the 3rd. Together with Agape, as you follow the Lenten calendar we've made available to you, it will tell you a food item that you can place into a box at your home every day for 40 days and then bring them. Because with Agape, we want to provide meals for over 95 families. You can find out more about this mission opportunity at the website, visiting us at www.trinityatlanta.org. As always, if you're experiencing a difficult life circumstance, or if you just want to reach out for some conversation and companionship by phone, our Stephen ministers stand ready to be in touch with you. You may reach out confidentially by emailing them at stephenminister@trinityatlanta.org. Now, please join me in the call to worship. From water to wilderness, God's covenant continues, God's kingdom draws near. On stone and in hearts, God's covenant continues, God's kingdom draws near. From the ancestor of nations to the sun lifted up, God's covenant continues, God's kingdom draws near. The journey through Lent is here.
Of Christ, my King. please join me now as we, the body of Christ, confess our sins together. God of mercy, we begin the season of Lent in confession. We do not live according to your ways, but according to our own. We condone violence and participate in systems of injustice. We use power to our own advantage at the expense of others. Forgive us, we pray. We are tempted to follow paths that are not the ones you prepare for us. In covenantal love, remember us, we pray. Before us, once more and always, an ark of safety and new life. In Christ's name we pray, amen. In Christ, we are given an overabundance of love, and that love poured out to each and every one of us offers us forgiveness. We are a forgiven people. To God be the glory. Amen.
Someday I'll wish upon a star and wake up where the clouds are far behind me. When trouble smells like lemon drops away above the chimney tops, that's where you'll find me.
Bible story is one we begin learning very early as children. It is the story which is often pictured on the cover of children's Bibles and involves an ark and lots of animals. Do you know which story I'm talking about? If you guessed Noah's Ark, you'd be right. Often I receive questions from parents about what kind of Bible they should look into for their children at certain ages. I can give some of my favorite examples, but one of the best ways to make this choice is for our parents to go to the story of Noah's Ark in whatever copy they've chosen and read through it to decide how appropriate it is for the child. Now, for my young friends, there is a part of this story you may not know. If you have the Jesus Storybook Bible at home, I know many of you do, I'd encourage you to read the Noah's Ark story from this with your families. This story tells us of a time when God was upset that the people were not thinking of God and were not doing good for each other. There was much hate and very little love. But we know God sent lots of people we've heard about through the Bible to teach us to spread love. Noah was one of those people. God asked Noah to build an ark, a giant boat, to prepare for a flood. Noah was pretty afraid and concerned that he didn't know what he was doing, but he trusted God and God helped him follow through. Now, the parts of this story we remember best are the animals which filled the ark. We also remember the end of this Bible story. God shared something as a promise to Noah and a reminder to us. Can you think of something we sometimes see in the sky after it rains? A rainbow, right? I won't give the story away, but listen as Pastor Kim tells us about that rainbow. Consider the last time you saw a rainbow. Did you think of God?
Let us pray. Gracious God, when we are in the midst of uncertainty, when the times seem dark, or even when our days are bright, we know that the light of your word can increase our ability to see and to hear. And so we pray that you will give us ears to hear and eyes to see your word revealed in scripture reading and in proclamation this day. In Christ's name we pray, amen. A reading from Genesis 9, verses 8 through 17. Then God said to Noah and to his sons who were with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood. Never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh, and the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is upon the earth." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This past week, the Lenten season began as usual in shades of gray with Wednesday's ashes. But of course, there was nothing usual about it, was there? In this viral pandemic, nothing of the church's life or its deepest rituals can be enacted as usual, because everything we do is dangerously communal, even intimate, as befits a faith grounded in incarnation. Our Christian faith is an enfleshed faith above all else. It is a faith that begins in washing with water scooped up, poured, running down our faces. It is a faith sustained by sharing pieces of bread from one loaf, passed hand to hand, a common cup taken to our lips. In the Christian year, there is no ritual more intimate than Ash Wednesdays, when we stand face to face, closer than we would normally dare, as ashes in the shape of a cross are marked upon our forehead. The same words are pronounced over each life, liturgical poetry giving way to the plain facts of the matter. Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Last week, after almost a year of weeks now, we had to reinvent yet another ritual in the church's life in order to protect life. So Andrew and Elizabeth and some others assembled over 100 plastic bags for you, each one including a small container of gray ash, buttons with crosses, prayer cards, a magnet, everything needed for a do-it-yourself Ash Wednesday, including our recorded service. You're tired of it. We know. So are we. So why not skip Lent altogether this year. I mean, who wants to give up anything for Lent, as the tradition goes, when we have already given up so much for so long in this ashen year? I have a book that is a collection of poems that were written in response to the pandemic so far. One of the contributing poets is Tommy Orange. His poem in the collection is entitled Aftermaths, and in it, he considers the many aftermaths we may each grapple with once this pandemic ends and our lives go on as they will, as they must. He notes that aftermath is an old English farming term referring to grass grown directly after a harvest. Grass growing after a harvest. Green new life springing up where the earth has been disrupted. There is hope, he says, in the word itself, aftermath. Hope then perhaps too in our own aftermaths. Tommy Orange then wonders if there may be something to begin to hope for even now as this extended year of Lent continues. His poem ends this way. Quarantine, he notes, comes from the Latin meaning 40 days. How long has it been? He asks, and how long will it be? And is it the same kind of 40 as from the ark and the flood, the devil in the desert and the 40-hour work week? How will we live our lives into something more? His poem ends with this naming of the biblical texts that are appointed for the first Sunday of Lent in 2021. The ark coming to rest after 40 days and 40 nights of watery chaos. Jesus wrestling with the devilish temptation to become someone else, to meet our expectations instead of God's. And then Tommy Orange invites us to think about who we are becoming in our 40-hour work weeks, or in these endless days that seem like their own watery chaos as we bob our way through them, hoping our personal arcs will hold until the ground returns beneath our feet. So this year I've decided we will not begin Lent in the wilderness of wild beasts and the devil. No, instead, Genesis is going to be our instituting guide for the way forward. And Genesis 9, 8 through 17 is anything but ashen gray. This text splashes the sky with a spectrum of colors in full. Lent for us this year begins with a rainbow. No matter what age we are, when a rainbow appears, we stop. Stare. I've even been known to pull off on the side of the road to marvel, tracing its arc from one end to the other. A rainbow, we know, is a natural phenomenon caused by water and light's refraction. But that doesn't mean that Genesis is wrong. For the rainbow is also a gift from God, a glad and hopeful appearance after the event of rain and storm, when cloud and light meet and awe overwhelms us. Lent this year begins, I think, where we most need it to, with the very first covenant God ever makes. Its sign is the rainbow, that bold display against an uncertain sky. God's first covenant is astonishingly generous, requiring nothing of us at all. God's first covenant is all one-sided. It is all God's doing. Notice how the I language God uses piles up one upon another, verse upon verse, making it clear that this covenant In this covenant, God is the initiator. God is the author. God, the sole notary. I am establishing my covenant, God says. I establish, I make, I have set, I bring, I will remember, I have established. Now, usually a covenant is a deal struck between two parties, partners, maybe even enemies. I will do this if you will do that. And it gets written down, signed by both parties, and then placed in a temple or a court for later reference by paragraphs of whereases and therefores. But not this covenant. This covenant is God's one-sided, multi-hued promise to stick with us no matter what, forever. It is unconditional, unilateral, eternal. No matter how awful we are or how terrible we may become, God promises forever to hang up his bow in the sky. In a divine act of unilateral disarmament, God's bow will remain undrawn, pointed away from us for all eternity. God's colorful signature is set in the heavens, visible to all. But there is more to this covenant. Because God makes this covenant, yes, with Noah and all of his descendants forever, which includes us. And then there is this too. God also includes every living creature and their future generations, the birds, domestic animals, every animal of the earth, those who came out of the ark, and I suppose also those who swam along beside it. God's first covenant is unconditional, it is unilateral, it is eternal, and it is cosmic. Now, I think that's a good way for Lent to begin. So, in these 40 days stretching beyond us, I propose that this Lent we focus on the generosity, the faithfulness of God, the colorful cosmic creation into which we have been placed, and the complex web of relationships that we have with all living things. Now, we Presbyterians are behind some other Christian and faith communities in this regard. Our Reformed tradition has been quite cautious about what we call natural theology, claiming that we can know God through our observations and experiences of the natural world. We Presbyterians have favored God's special revelations, those that come to us through the mighty acts of God in history, and especially in the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But Lent's beginning for us this year is this story, a story that binds us seamlessly to God and to creation. Our lives are lived not in the God who turns against us in a destructive flood of anger, but our lives are lived with a God who promises always to turn toward us and all living things in forgiveness and compassion and life-giving love. Now, we do have a lot to learn, or maybe relearn, from ancient spiritualities that have always held together God and the natural world. We could look to ancient Celtic spirituality. We can look to Native American and other indigenous spiritualities. They have so much to offer, as do the mystics and the saints of the Middle Ages, Hildegard of Bingen, Saint Bonaventure, and of course, Saint Francis of Assisi, who would call creatures, no matter how small, by the name brother or sister, because he knew they shared with him the same beginning. I'm enjoying very much reading Richard Rohr, who is a Catholic priest He's written a book called The Cosmic Christ, and he writes daily meditations that come to my inbox in this year ahead, exploring this cosmic Christ. The Franciscan metaphor of the great chain of being God seems to have built in to the cosmos. In this Ashen year, we have given up so much for so long. This Lent, then, let's let our focus be on what we can add. What we can add that will honor God's unconditional, unilateral, eternal, and cosmic covenant. Living creatures depend upon us for their welfare, and our human welfare depends upon theirs as well. So what practices, what offerings in these 40 days ahead of us can we engage that will contribute beauty and color, forgiveness, compassion, and life-giving love as a reflection of all that God has covenanted to give to us? What can we do in this season that will help grass to grow after all this disrupted harvest? Our 40 things in 40 days is one possibility. There's a calendar giving you the opportunity to add food to a box each day for 40 days. And at the end, we will be providing meals for over 95 families who don't have enough to eat in this difficult time. Maybe you have other ideas of ways that you can add life and health to a neighbor or a church member you know here, to the living creatures who share your patch of ground wherever you live day in and day out. Every day as I drive and arrive onto Trinity's spacious natural setting, I take delight in noticing the sign that declares our congregation's commitment to offer the birds of the air a needed habitat among us. And I sometimes wonder what other ways Trinity might imagine doing even more. So for Lent this year, I'm for being less dour and more colorful. Focus less on our sin and move more toward God's cosmic covenant of forgiveness and compassion and life-giving love. Jan Richardson is a contemplative in the Reformed tradition who often offers art and liturgy together. And this year, she had a liturgy for Ash Wednesday that I think seems to get us started in this direction, reminding us that even the dust that we are is part of something bigger and grander, not because of who we are, but because of who God is and who God wants so much for us to become. She writes this, "So let us be marked, not for sorrow, and let us be marked, not for shame. Let us be marked not for false humility or for thinking we are less than we are, but for claiming what God can do within the dust, within the dirt, within the stuff of which the world is made, and the stars that blaze in our bones, and the galaxies that spiral inside the smudge we bear." Friends, let's enter these 40 days knowing that we enter them within God's first unconditional, unilateral, eternal, and cosmic covenant, knowing that the aftermath of all that has been will be green, new life, like grass after a harvest. May it be so in us and among us and out there in all creation. Amen.
Friends, let us pray. O Lord, our God, as we sit in quietness, our thoughts are far from quiet. We are wrestling with doubts and fears. We are looking for answers. We are hoping against hope. We are seeking strength. We are hungry for warm sunshine, for healed bodies, for rest from tears. Your word says the hungry will be filled, and we ask today for you to fill us. Fill us with the breath of life. Fill us with thankful hearts. Fill us with calmness, courage, and most of all, with the knowledge of your presence. God of the nations, we pray for peace with justice throughout the world, so that all your children may dwell secure, free of war and injustice. Move the hearts of leaders throughout the world to hear the cries of the poor and hungry, and to ensure a rightful share of the resources needed to sustain all life. As we continue to grapple with overwhelming pandemic challenges, we pray that you would grant special measures of strength and endurance to healthcare workers and other essential workers who labor on the front lines of this struggle. And we pray for all who are now facilitating vaccination and for those who are providing the vaccines. God, we pray for your comfort for all who are sick and for all who have lost loved ones. Surround them with your strong healing presence. Grant wisdom to those who need answers to difficult questions. Grant hope to those who despair and friendship to those who feel lonely. Most of all, Lord God, may we know your love, your great love which you have for each one of us. May we not lose sight of your constant care. Creator God, let the rain come and wash away the ancient grudges, the bitter hatreds held and nurtured over generations. Let the rain wash away the memory of the hurt, the neglect. Then let the sun come out and fill the sky with rainbows. Let the warmth of the sun heal us where we are broken. Let it burn away the fog so that we can see each other clearly, so that we can see beyond labels, beyond accents, gender, or skin color. Let the warmth and brightness of the sun melt our selfishness so that we can share the joys and feel the sorrows of our neighbors. And let the light of the sun be so strong that we will see all people as our neighbors. Let the earth, nourished by rain, bring forth flowers to surround us with beauty. And let the mountains teach our hearts to reach upwards to heaven. As we embark on this Lenten journey, God, we pray for your comfort. We pray for you to bring us together. We seek renewal and restoration during these 40 days. Remind us, O God, that perhaps this isn't the year to give up, not the year to deprive ourselves of the little joys to which we've clung, not the year to focus on mortality, to sit in the ash heap, or to wallow in the depth of sin and brokenness. God, perhaps this is the year to remember that from dust we were born and reborn, created and recreated, formed and reformed. Remind us of this, O God. Remind us that this is the year for something life-giving and spirit-fulfilling. This is the year to commit to a practice that brings a bit more joy, a bit more hope, a bit more promise. God, help us. Let this Lent be an intentional walk towards Sunday, not a somber journey towards Friday. Let this Lent remind us of the spring that is surely coming. Let this Lent be the one which we remember that out of ashes comes new life, unbidden, surprising, and desperately needed. God, grant us all wisdom and courage for the living of this hour. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, in Lent, we remember the gifts of nourishment that God gives us during our wilderness journey. Let us now share our gifts in joyful response to God's sustaining grace. I invite you to give online or via text using the instructions on your screen. You may also mail a check to the church. Let us give generously as a reflection of God's generosity towards us.
Friends, we have been set into this world in a cosmic creation born of relationships between us and all living things with the God who comes toward us always with forgiveness and compassion and life-giving love. May we live that covenant with one another and in all of our relationships. And may the grace of Christ attend you and the love of God surround you and the Holy Spirit keep you, that you may live in faith and grow in love and abound in hope this day and forever. Amen.